Hi, I'm William Taylor, and welcome to the first Spec Lab video on data visualization. This video is part of a larger Introduction to R series on our channel, so if you're new to R, please be sure to watch those videos first before starting with this one. So in our lab, we use the ggplot2 package to create our figures because it's very flexible and it's easy to make publication-grade plots with. So let's walk through this script and look at some examples. So the first thing we're going to do is clear out our environment. As you can see, I have some objects left over from a previous project. We're starting something new, so I want to go ahead and clear this out. The next thing we want to do is set our working directory. So this is where you have your training datasets stored at. So for me, that's this file path. The next thing we want to do is go ahead and actually install the ggplot2 package, which we'll be working with. I have this line commented out, but if you're running ggplot2 for the first time, you want to make sure you install it using this command on line 18. So after we've installed the ggplot2 package, the next thing we want to do is actually load it into our current R session so we can use it. So we're going to do that here on line 21. So the next thing we're going to do is read in the CSV file with the data set that we're going to be looking at. So we can read it in here on line 24, and we can open it up and take a look at it. So for some context, this is a data set pulled from the World Bank. And in this data, each row is an observation representing a single country in a single year, and each column is a variable that represents information about that country in that year. So for example, we have the country of Afghanistan in the year 1992, and we have information about the percentage of energy use that came from renewables in that country in that year. So notice that when we load in this data here on line 25, we specify the strings as factors parameter as equal to false. We do that so that R doesn't try to turn character strings, in this case our country names, into factors, which are usually reserved for categorical variables. So you're here for visualization. Let's talk about visualization. The first thing we're going to do is create a histogram. Now histograms tell us the distribution of a variable, whether the data is spread out or packed together. We can visually analyze whether we have clusters of observations at certain values. So maybe, for example, we have lots of less rich countries and a very few middle income countries and lots of rich countries if we were looking at GDP as an example. So here on line 31, we will start with a ggplot call, which is the command to set up many different plot types using the ggplot2 package. We specify the name of our dataset as WDI, which we initialized up here, and then we use the aesthetics command to specify the variables that we want to pull from. So we're saying, hey, from the WDI dataset, we want to pull the electricity underscore pop variable, this column, and we want to put it on the x-axis. Then on the line below that, we'll add a call to geom underscore histogram, which tells ggplot that a histogram is the type of graph that we want. So we can run this command, and when we run it, notice that we have a new object in our environment, but we don't have a new plot in our plots pane. That's because we assigned this ggplot call, the output from this ggplot call, to an object. This is useful if you want to save the graph, which we'll show you in the final video in this module. But for now, if we want to look at this graph, we have to actually call on the name of the object. So we do that here on line 35. So here we have our histogram. So now is a good time to pause and dissect what we just did. So each figure made by ggplot has three basic components: the data set we're pulling from, a set of aesthetic mappings, which is AES up here on line 31, which maps the data to the plot, and at least one layer that describes how to render the plot. So in this case, we specified we wanted a histogram. So when we're making a histogram, we can tell ggplot how many bins we want to split into. This is an example of the wide array of customizations that we can make using ggplot. So in this case, we have 30 bins, so we have 30 bars. Bins are basically telling ggplot how many bars to split up our data into. So maybe we don't want the default of 30 bars. Maybe we want 10 bars, 10 bins. So this call on line 48 is very, very similar to our call on line 31. The only difference is, as a parameter in geom underscore histogram, we specify bins is equal to 10, as opposed to bins is equal to 30, which if you look down here in the console is the default. So we can call this, we create a new object called plot1a. It's now in our environment, and now we can run it. Now we have a plot with 10 bins, 10 bars, instead of the original default 30. So let's wrap this up. We made a simple histogram plotting the distribution of a single variable, electricity underscore pop. And as we move through these trainings, we'll show you how to make more complex figures with multiple variables in the same plot, multiple plots in the same figure, and how to make those figures look good. Up next, we'll look at how to make kernel density plots and start to play around with more customizations such as colors, line types, and labels.